Hello everyone, I'm Sushmita Sarkar. I am assistant professor from RV College of Engineering, Bangalore. I welcome all of you for lecture 7 in Power System Analysis 2, Module 1. So till our last class, we have learned what are the different methods of forming Y-bus. Okay, so I hope all of you have understood the formation of Y-bus with inspection method and with singular transformation method. So we have covered this much of part in our last 6 lectures. So today we'll be concentrating on load flow problem. So we'll start our load flow problem and then we will come for next lecture in Gauss-Seidel method. So let us start, what is load flow problem and why do we have to study this load flow analysis? Fine, so why we have to study this load flow concept? Okay, because this load flow gives us, first thing, the complex voltages at all the buses. Okay, basically it gives us complex voltages at all the buses. With that, it also helps us to give the power flow in all the lines in and the line losses. So please remember, the basic concept of load flow analysis is to get the complex voltages at all the buses and power flows at all the lines and their line losses. With that, it also helps us to study the existing network and for the expansion, for the existing network, if you have to expand, then it gives this analysis will help us to do that. Fine, so, or it also helps us to build us all together a new network. Fine, so these are very important points. So please remember, I repeat, this helps us to get the complex voltages at every buses. Second, it helps us to get the power flows at all the lines and the line losses. It helps us to study the existing network. It also gives us the provision for expansion of the existing network. Plus, it also helps us to build a new network altogether. Fine, now what are the main 4 quantities or the parameters which we need to do this load flow analysis? The very first parameter we required is real power P. Second parameter is reactive power Q. Third parameter is magnitude of voltage. And the fourth and the last parameter is angle of voltage, which we call it as delta. So based on these 4 parameters, we define the number of buses, fine? So in every buses, out of these 4 parameters, 2 parameters values will be known, other 2 parameters values will be unknown. So let us see what are the different type of buses available in power system. Fine, so with that, we say classification of buses. So please remember, basically in the power system, there are mainly 2 types of buses. One we call it as a generator bus, another we call it as a load bus. The third type of the bus which comes into the picture, that is due to the necessity. Find the requirement to compensate the losses into the power system. We come out with the third classification, and the third classification is called as a slack bus or swing bus or a reference bus. So let us start the first bus which we call it as a generator bus or a PV bus. As the name says, in this particular bus, what are the 2 quantities out of the 4 quantities are known to me? That is P bus, P value and V value, which means you know in this particular bus, the real power value and the voltage value, magnitude of the voltage. Okay, then next is which bus? Next is your load bus or PQ bus. Fine, one more thing, the generator bus is also called as a voltage controlled bus. So you call it as a generator bus or PV bus or a voltage controlled bus, okay? Second bus, we call it as a load bus or PQ bus. So in this particular bus, we know the value of P and Q, that is real power and reactive power. The magnitude of the voltage and the angle of the voltage need to be identified. Third, I told you the third kind of bus, which we call it as a slack bus, fine, or it is called as a swing bus or it is reference bus. So the concept of this bus comes to compensate for the losses, but basically in the system you have only 2 types of buses. So now the question comes, any bus in the system can be given as a reference bus, can be taken as a reference bus or a slack bus or swing bus? The answer is no. The slack bus has to be a generator bus, and that generator should be the highest capacity among all the other generators. So basically, you have to choose a bus with the highest capacity, generating capacity. Bus will be considered as slack bus or swing bus, because this particular bus has to generate for the or supply for the losses in the transmission lines. Fine. So what are the two parameters which are known for this particular bus? So this particular bus, the magnitude of the voltage and angle is known, and the P and Q is unknown. So let us understand the whole concept once again in a tabular form. Fine. So now I put a table for this, so for all of you to understand it much more clearly, that these are the three type buses available, in which out of the four parameters which we have learned, real power, reactive power, magnitude of voltage and angle, out of these four parameters, for each of these buses, two parameters will be known and two will be unknown. So you can see, just recall once again, slack bus, what is known, what are the known parameters? Magnitude of voltage and angle. What is unknown? P and Q. Generator bus, which is also called as a PV bus or voltage control bus, the parameters which are known is P and V. What we supposed to find out is Q and delta. Okay, this has to be magnitude of V actually. Then the load bus we have PQ bus. So in this case, you know the value of P and Q, and what is unknown is V and delta. There is one more thing which is which will be given in a generator bus data, that is generator limits. Okay, so that is your Q limits. Fine. Here I just make one changes. Here you know the value of P and the magnitude of Q. Okay. Apart from this, the generator bus will also give you the Q limits. So you will be knowing the value of Q minimum and Q maximum. Fine. So with this particular basic, let us know what is the static load flow equation to do the load flow analysis. Fine. So to do the static load flow equation, we already have covered in last few lectures that we know the relationship I is equal to Y into V. So you take it a matrix of a three bus system, where these are your injected bus currents and these are your bus voltages. So, and these are your driving point and transfer admittances, that is your Y bus. Fine. Now I want to write this particular matrix in an equation form. So how do I put this complete matrix into an equation form? So what we do is we take just first, let us write an equation for bus one. So how do I write, guys, for bus one? So you just check it out. This is my bus one. So if I have to write the equation for bus one, which means say this particular line, okay, at this particular column, the first row of the Y bus and the bus voltage column has to be multiplied. So Y11 is basically is Y11 into V1, Y12 into V2 plus Y12 into V3. So how do we write it? So I can also write it in the form of summation. Q is equal to 1 to 3. Okay. Q is equal to 1 to 3. Y1Q, VQ. Okay. So I am taking the Q terms as, just taking a different color to make you understand. So this is acting as a Q. This is one is Q, okay? Two is Q. So you can see this is 1, 2, 3, okay? So 1, 2, 3, this is our Q. So this is your 1, 2, 3. So these are also Q. So you are taking the Q from 1, 2, 3. Fine, so basically you are taking a Q from, this is your Q, one is here, this is Q. I'm taking Q 1, 2, 3. So whereas one, I have written I1, this is I1 equation. So I1 is summation, Q is equal to 1 to 3, Y1Q multiplied by VQ. So I hope all of you have understood this particular equation for this above matrix. Fine. So I will be putting it in more general. So instead of one, this is the same equation will hold good for two also. When I write I2, what I'll be writing, guys? So I'll be writing I2 is equal to sigma, Q is equal to 1 to 3, Y2Q into VQ. Similarly, I3, I'll be writing it as I3 is equal to, Q is equal to 1 to 3, Y3Q, VQ. So in general, I can write it as IP, instead of writing 1, 2, 3 till n number of buses, if my system is having n number of buses, so I should always write a mathematical model in a general form. So what is the general form says? So this will become IP is equal to Q is equal to 1 to n, because we are talking about generalized form n number of buses. So if your system is having n number of buses, so Q is equal to 1 to n, YPQ, VQ. Fine, this is your P. I'm taking this particular, you're talking about the first bus. So this has become your P. Fine, so this has become your P. So it is IP is equal to sigma Q is equal to, this will become n, okay, YPQ, VQ. Okay, so I hope this is clear to all of you. Now in this term, we will be trying to take the PP term outside. Let us see what is there next. Fine, so for n is equal, for n buses where P comma Q is equal to 1 to n number of buses, I'll be writing it as, I will be taking the YPP term outside. Okay, so your Q is equal to 1 to n number of buses as well as P is equal to 1 number n number of buses, which I told you already. So you need to write much more generalized form. Basically, what is that static load flow equation we are trying to derive? You remember the first thing in load flow problem, that why I'm doing this analysis. So the very first concept why you are doing this analysis is, guys, that is you want to know the bus, complex bus voltages at each bus, okay? So my equation, I'm trying to derive that bus voltage equation. So that bus voltage equation, I got the bus current equation. So the bus current equation is IP is equal to sigma Q is equal to 1, YPQ, VQ, okay? But when it is a question of a VP, I required a bus voltage at a particular bus, then I need to take that P term outside. So what I'm doing is IP is equal to YPP, VP, plus sigma is equal to Q is equal to 1 to n, but not equal to P. It's missing over here. So you have to write sigma is equal to Q to 1 to n, but not equal to P, YPQ, VQ, because P term you have already taken out over here. Since you, from this sigma sign, you have already taken the P term outside, hence in this summation you write Q is equal to 1 to n, but not equal to P. Fine. So we'll see what is next. So what is next? It shows over here. Now from here, I write the VP equation. So how I'm writing the VP equation? This second term will go towards this side. So you get IP minus of sigma YPQ VQ, and this YPP will come down. So you get it as VP is equal to 1 divided by YPP IP minus of sigma YPQ VQ. I hope it is clear for all of you. Just rearrange the above equation to get the equation in terms of VP. Fine. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to substitute that value of IP over here, because still your input data is not in the form of IP. Okay. So let us see how to remove this IP from this equation number one. Okay. So now we know the conjugate power SP is equal to VP IP conjugate, that is VI conjugate. So which we write PP minus of JQP. Fine, I want the equation in terms of IP, not IP conjugate, because I need to replace this IP. So in order to replace this IP, I need the equation to be in IP format, not IP conjugate. So to remove this conjugate, what I need to do, I need to take SP conjugate. So when you take SP conjugate, it becomes VP conjugate into IP is equal to PP minus of JQP. Fine. So I hope all of you know this. Once you take the conjugate, the reactive power will get affected. So a minus sign comes in front of it. Fine. In case of a polar form, angle will become negative. Fine. So if it is SP conjugate, you got now in terms of VP conjugate, IP is equal to PP minus of JQ. So now from this particular equation, I get the value of IP. So what will get IP, guys? So here from IP will be equal to PP minus of JQP divided by VP conjugate. And that particular value I am going to substitute in equation number one. Okay, I repeat, IP value from here, you will be getting from here. So this VP value will come over here. Okay, so divided by this VP value will come down. So that IP value you are going to substitute over here. So let us see in our next slide what is done. So see, IP is equal to PP minus of JQP VP conjugate. So you get it as VP is equal to 1 by YPP, PP minus of JQP, VP conjugate minus sigma Q is equal to 1 to N, but not equal to P, YPQ, VQ. Okay. So now this is called as static load flow equation. Fine. And this equation is nonlinear in nature. So why the static load flow equation is nonlinear in nature? The reason is you have the same term present in both the sides of the equation, which is VP over here, and you can see VP over here. So the same term is present in both the sides of the equation. Hence, it makes the SLFE, in short, which we call it as static load flow equation, as nonlinear equation, fine? So this is the formula by which we find out the complex voltage at every bus to do the load flow analysis. Fine, guys, I hope this concept is clear for you. So since your static load flow equation is nonlinear, fine, that is the reason we go for an iterative techniques. This kind of solutions cannot, this kind of equations cannot be solved in a normal way. So you have to go for an iterative procedures. So what are these iterative procedures? So before going to the iterative procedures, let us understand how do I write the static load flow equations at a different bus point, fine? So now suppose you have n number of buses. Let us consider we have n number of buses and you are going to write a voltage equation for bus number one, fine? So just put it in that formula. You are getting it as V1 is equal to 1 by Y11, P1 minus JQ1 divided by V1 conjugate minus sigma. Q is equal to what we used to write, guys. We used to write Q is equal to, Q is equal to 1, okay, 2N, but not equal to P. Okay, so all of you can see here that that was your sigma sign you used to write, sigma. So sigma Q is equal to 1 to N, not equal to P. So in this case, your P is 1. Okay, so in this case, your P is 1. So you have to write, so you're not writing 1 over here. So you're writing Q is equal to 2 to 4 Y1Q VQ. Fine, so that is your equation for this. If you want, you can expand this, open the bracket and write the complete equation for this. So when you expand this particular term, your equation look like this. V1 is equal to 1 by Y11, P1 minus of JQ1, V1 conjugate minus Y1, you remember this one is there. What is Q? Q starts from 2. So Y12, V2, V is also Q. So both Qs, your first term is 2. So substitute 2 over here. So you get Y12, V2 minus, then Q will increment to next number 3. You will get Y13, V3, okay? Next, you will get it as 4, so it becomes Y14, V4. So this is the equation of static load flow at a particular bus 1. Fine, so similarly, I'll be writing the same equation at bus 2. So I hope all of you will be able to write now what is the bus 2 static load flow equation. So what will happen? This will become V2 is equal to 1 by Y22, P2 minus of JQ2, V2 conjugate, minus Y21 V1 minus Y23 V3 minus Y24 V4. Okay, I repeat, let us see how does it look. V2 is equal to, because right now your P becomes 2, right? So remember that P becomes 1 to 2, your P becomes 2 and Q will become 1 to N but not equal to 2. That means Q basically you are taking 1 to 4 but not equal to 2 because right now your P is 2. So that 2 term will go out. So what happens? V2 is equal to 1 by Y22, P2 minus of JQ2 divided by V2 conjugate minus, it is your, for your second bus voltage. So you are writing Y21, V1, fine, Y23, V3 minus Y24, V4. Okay, so remember Q is equal to 1 to N, N is your 4, N is given as 4, 1 to 4, but not equal to P. So you can see you will not get V2 term over here because V2 itself you are finding out. So V2 term will not be present over here as you are finding out the same bus voltage over here. Fine. So I hope now all of you will be able to write at bus 3. Yes, please tell me. Bus 3 will be V3 is equal to 1 by Y33 P3 minus of JQ3 divided by V3 conjugate minus Y31 V1 minus Y32 V2 minus Y34 V4. I hope it is clear. So you can see over here, your Q goes from 1 to N, but not equal to P. In this case, P is 3. So 3 you are finding out. So that voltage 3 will not be present. And similarly, you will not have any term called Y33 V3 because Y33 is present here. Fine. So we have already taken in our general equation the P term outside, and exactly we are finding out the bus voltage at that particular P bus only. So similarly, I'll be writing the equation for bus 4. So Y4 is equal to 1 by Y44. V4 is equal to 1 by Y44. P4 minus of JQ4. V4 conjugate minus Y41 V1 minus Y42 V2 minus Y43 V3. So Q is from, once again, 1 to N, but not equal to P. So this time your P itself is a 4. So the last term will not come over here because you are finding out the same voltage over here. Fine. So I hope the static load flow equation you have understood, because this particular equation, guys, you need to remember, because you need to use the same static load flow equation in your next Gauss Seidel method. Fine. So with this, we should understand this particular line is written only if in your system you have only PQ buses. So first we will learn how the load flow analysis will be done only for PQ buses. Once the knowledge of with PQ buses is understood to all of us, then automatically we'll understand when the PV buses are included, how does the algorithm changed, okay? So in general, for a system with N buses, one of the bus, because you know out of N number of buses, one bus will be taken as a slack bus. And that particular bus voltage is already given. So you need not to calculate the voltage for the slack bus again. It has already been specified. So if you have N number of buses in your system, except the slack bus, rest all the other buses voltages you need to determine. That is in case of PQ buses. If your all the buses except the slack buses are PQ buses. So it says, hence you will have N minus one static load flow equations which need to be solved. So my dear friends, please remember this whole goods when we talk about the PQ buses, okay? Then you have N minus of one number of bus voltages which you need to find out, because slack bus voltage is already being specified. Fine. So since these equations are nonlinear in nature, so we need to go for an iterative technique to get the solution. Fine. And also, you know why SLFE is nonlinear? Because a VP term is present in both the sides of the SLFE, Okay. So what are these methods? Fine. So basically we have three methods, but the starting method I would like to explain you in my next lecture, because I want to tell you that what is the difference of Gauss elimination method. A few people also call it as a Gauss method, and after the updated version of it came as a Gauss Seidel method. So once we are studying about a Gauss Seidel method, we also should know what is Gauss method or Gauss elimination method. Fine. So this is what you have in your module one till the GS method, as other two methods will be discussed in module two. Fine. So this is your, so first method we usually find out for use for load flow analysis is GS method, that is Gauss Seidel method. Second method is Newton-Raphson method, NR method in short. And the third is fast decouple load flow method, which in short we call it as an FDLF method. Okay. So believe me, all these methods are very interesting and pay interest for all the lectures. So you will literally enjoy these classes of load flow analysis, fine? So I will be covering these two points of GS and GS model in my next lecture. So let us see what quiz is awaiting for us. So let us see the quiz questions. Fine, I hope all of you are waiting for this quiz session. Okay, I know all of you have understood and you would like to answer some questions. Okay, so the first question is, what are the quantities unknown for voltage control bus? I repeat, what are the quantities unknown for voltage control bus? Okay, so I know all of you know the answer. What is unknown? What is voltage control bus? It is a PV bus. So which means P and V value is known. So what is unknown is Q and delta. So the answer is the reactive power and the angle of voltage. So these are the two values which are unknown for voltage controlled bus. So read the questions clearly, whether we are asking for known or it is for unknown. Fine, I hope this is clear, because voltage control bus is nothing but your PV bus. Okay. Question number two. Why SLF is non-linear? We have discussed so many times this question, because we know the term VP is present in both the sides of the equation. Okay, so by now I think it's by-hearted for everybody, and everybody has understood why SLF is non-linear. And the question can also be asked, why do we go for technical iterative techniques for load flow analysis? So the answer is, we go for iterative technique in load flow analysis as the SLFE is non-linear in nature. Fine, so now the question three. Can any bus in the system be a slack bus? What is the answer? Can any bus in the system be a slack bus? So answer is yes or no. Yes, very good. The answer is no. Okay, the answer is no. The bus with the highest generating capacity will be considered as slack bus, as this particular bus has to supply the losses. Okay. I hope. Okay, we have one more question. Question number four. What is the need of load flow studies? Fine. Very good question. What is the need? Why do you want to do load flow studies? Fine. So the answer is, the load flow study of a power system is essential to decide the best operation of existing system and for future planning. Fine. It's very simple. If I want my grid to work, okay, without any interruption, I should know what are the line flows are in my transmission lines. Fine. I should know every bus voltages. So if we have this particular analysis, then only we know that whether this particular demand can be met or not, or whether it is exceeding the demand or not, or whether the network can be extended in future or not. So this basically gives us, help us for to maintain the present existing system or to extend the future system. Okay, so it helps us in future expansion of the system. It is also essential for designing a new power system. Fine. Another question, why do we go for iterative methods to solve load flow problems? Just now we have discussed, we go for iterative methods as our SLFE is non-linear in nature. And why it is so? The answer is, the load flow equations are non-linear algebraic equation, and so explicit solution is not possible. The solution for non-linear equations can only be obtained by iterative numerical techniques. So, okay, so all the basic concepts, I hope I have made you clear. So with this basic concepts, we will go for the next lecture, which is a Gauss-Seidel method. Okay, so thank you for listening. Have a nice day, everyone. Bye.